I'm Bill Potter. I'm serving as an advisor to the National Institute of Mental Health, but I've also been involved. I've had the pleasure of being involved with the FNIH biomarkers consortium and all. Is this working?
Sorry, so we're going to go ahead and get started so we can stay on track. So okay. We're going to start up with session two,
right,
which is co-chaired by Bill Potter and Danielle Graham.
And Danielle Graham from Biogen. And just so, I've been working with the FNIH since the whole program started years ago because we were looking for a way to tackle some of these big questions in the field. And we'll come back to this at the end. And the reason I wanted to briefly set this up, this session is labeled as if it's fluid biomarkers. And because what you've heard about mainly this morning are quantitative fluid biomarkers. But for many of our disorders, we are interested in functional brain markers. So we're going to introduce for contrast, what you can do, what are the standards, what are the performance characteristics that you can achieve in the fluid biomarker space versus a hint of what we're beginning to try to do in the functional space using EEG as a measure. Some questions came up this morning which began to touch on that. Does the measurement platform influence the path to figuring out your biomarker? And although in theory they should be independent, I think what we're going to learn is we may have to think a little differently about the performance characteristics we can achieve in the functional area. But I think we need to be very clear on that. So without further ado, I'm going to ask Les Shaw to start out with, and Les heads up fundamentally the control of all the fluid measures, I mean cerebrospinal fluid and all, from ADNI, and has done a fantastic job of helping us in this space. And is going to speak to some of the very practical issues with which we struggle. Les.
Thanks, Bill. Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to be here with you to talk about something that is very close to my heart and I'm very passionate about, and that is AD fluid biomarkers. So I think it's probably useful, helpful perhaps, just to take a step back and think about the patient who's visiting their physician in a brain, in a neurodegenerative disease clinic, a memory disorders clinic typically, at how broad the differential diagnosis is for cognitive decline in later life. It really is a very wide range of possibilities that our clinical colleagues have to wrestle with. Trying to get this to work. As they work with their individual patients. We're going to come back to this with an actual patient scenario shared with me by a neurologist colleague later on in this presentation. But again, just taking a deep breath and step back at plaques and tangles in the original discovery by Dr. Alzheimer, who was a psychiatrist. And at that time, at the turn of the century, in Europe especially, psychiatrists were often pathologists as well, a very interesting combination. And so when his famous patient, who was in her late 50s, I believe, with early developed Alzheimer's disease, presented, and he worked her up, and then she passed away. He was able to examine her brain, as we know, and led to the discovery by conventional microscopy techniques of plaques and tangles. And again, something that many of us are very familiar with is the overall schematic for the development of amyloid beta neuritic plaques, as well as paired helical filamental neurofibrillary tangles presented schematically here, just for a reminder of what those processes are without trying to delve into them too deeply. This, I think, is a very important picture of a brain that has been examined for plaques and tangles by conventional immunohistochemical methodologies. And as Cliff Jack and maybe one or two others have referred to before, the typical neuritic plaque is a very complex entity comprised not only of fibrillized amyloid beta 1 to 42 and some other A-beta species, peptide species, but also remnants of neurites, microglia in the surrounding area, and so on. And so it's really a hodgepodge mixture of things. And the reason I emphasize that is when we think of amyloid PET scanning and what it largely detects, is it's largely detecting these kinds of plaques, the complicated ones. They're not just amyloid beta enriched, but they also have a fair amount of tau as well. And that is one of the reasons why we believe that the concordance between amyloid beta 42 and CSF and plaque burden measured by imaging is not as good as a combination of tau or p-tau and a-beta in terms of ratios and other ways of combining them. And we'll see that data, come back to that data a little bit later on. And of course, the tangles are intracellular aggregates shown in the couple of them. My pointer is not working very well. I apologize. But the blue arrows showing a couple of examples of neurons loaded with intracellular tangles and are well under the way to destruction. A very nice review paper by Olson and colleagues recently published just schematically helps us to get a sense of what kinds of changes are typical, not that they really are typical because there's quite a range of them, for the Alzheimer's disease presence in a brain that has, in terms of correlating what we see in the brain with what we see in cerebrospinal fluid. So typically a 50% reduction of amyloid beta 1 to 42, 200% increase in phospho-tau, 300% increase in total tau, again, with a wide range around those numbers, but just to give a little bit of a perspective. Now, since the 1990s, there's been a steady evolution of research use only types of immunoassays, their development, their implementation in various studies. And this PowerPoint is a summary that was provided by Juhi Kang in a review paper in 2013, just summarizing what do we see in terms of sensitivity and specificity across many studies, summarized numerically in the table to the right. So for example, 19 studies looking at AD versus HC, a very simplistic approach, but a good start, the approach to understanding these biomarkers and the detection of disease. So there were 19 of those studies, 26 studies that looked at total tau, 16 phospho-tau, and 16 the combination of A-beta 42 and total tau. And then AD versus non-AD are much more closer to the real world of what clinicians will be faced with when they use these tests is AD versus non-AD and so on. And so we see a picture of sensitivity and specificities in the 80s for the AD versus HC, somewhat lower for A-beta tau, phospho-tau for AD versus non-AD. But when you take tau and p-tau into account, we do a much better job of differentiating AD from non-AD, especially FTLD as compared to AD. In a study that we did in concert with the ADNI study, firstly defining cut points and then sensitivity specificity using autopsy as the gold standard, which it is, we were able to define sensitivity and specificity and noted a bit of an improvement in sensitivity and specificity when we combine tau and ApoE for with A-beta 42. The immunoassay we used at that time was the AlzBio3 bead-based immunoassay, no longer produced, but in the hands of experienced lab, this test was reasonably reliable at detecting amyloidopathy and tauopathy in the sense that we described that for CSF measurement, but was very poor when it came to lab-to-lab performance and had other issues like did not have an accuracy basis. So at this point in our discussion, we understand today more clearly than ever that clinical diagnosis of AD is imprecise. Maybe a clinical diagnosis rate of 70% sensitivity, a specificity 80% sensitivity, using consensus diagnostic criteria for probable AD in patients filed clinically at expert research centers. But the earlier and earlier we go in terms of identifying AD in the sense that Cliff Jack spoke about earlier, the earlier and earlier we go, the MCI stage or the preclinical stage, there's less and less clinical signs that are specific to AD so that one cannot be very confident in saying too much about AD presence in the prodromal and preclinical stages. And confusion with other dementia is very common. Now, we understand that amyloid PET, and there are three different ligands FDA approved for detecting amyloid plaque burden, are out there. They serve, if we can use the word, and it can be mixed up a little bit, but it's not intended to be, as a surrogate for autopsy detection of pathology. And that has led to the current way to test out how good are my CSF biomarkers doing to a sensitivity specificity. As we now use FDA-approved techniques like the amyloid PET methods for that standard of truth. And that has, I think, helped a lot in terms of better, more systematic studies that you can have a lot better crosstalk across what the results mean, their interpretation. So the leading hypotheses then in the CSF space is that CSF biochemical biomarkers, in addition to imaging biomarkers, will improve clinical diagnostic accuracy, that's a hypothesis, and will hypothetically predict risk of progression from AD to AD from prodromal and preclinical disease. And we're going to look at some data on how well we're doing in that realm using CSF biomarkers. This, I think, if there's any lesson learned in developing biomarkers, and everyone in this room has probably experienced different stages of this, is that it's an iterative process, and I think Hugo van der Stickle put that very well, and that there's peaks and valleys. The first peak is we've discovered the biomarker, we've got some great data, it looks promising. We then go to present it to the FDA or to other peer review committees and processes, and we start to realize that we got a lot more work to do to prove benefit, to prove utility, robustness, ruggedness, et cetera, et cetera. So there are ups and downs, and we're going to share some of the ups and downs that we've had in the CSF space, where I believe today in the CSF biomarkers that are highly automated, and there are several of these now, that we're at a pretty mature stage of the development of these biomarkers. Their time has come, in my view, to start to cross over the into the clinic. So along the way in that arduous process that have been very helpful and important in getting us to where we're at today have been the multi-center studies devoted to standardizing AD biomarker measurements. Starting in 2003, the Descripa study started to develop screening guidelines and criteria for pre-dementia AD and how biomarkers fit in. The ADNI study in 04, the ABLE Australian study in 06, Japanese ADNI in 07, the DIANE study in 08, the BioFinder 2010, and the PPMI in the Parkinson's space in 2010. Each of these is very committed to identifying and fixing and making better at every level possible standardization processes. So where are we at a little bit more? Long-term experience with the research use only immunoassays, that are some of which are still used at this current time and have been very valuable, although with their limitations. Clinical diagnostic performance data comparing AD and HD and other neurodegenerative diseases. Mostly clinical diagnosis used as standard of truth in the earlier studies, and more recently, amyloid PET or CSF-AD biomarkers as the standard of truth when we're studying what's going on in AD patients and MCI patients and in preclinical folks who are healthy controls. The new criteria for AD pathology is helping drive what's going on, but very importantly has been recognition of pre-analytical sources of variability, very important and crucial to recognize and control. And I'm happy to comment on that maybe in the panel discussion later as to a study that is at a high level of final stages of planning that hopefully will hit the nail on the head regarding pre-analytical. The analytical we'll talk a little bit more about. A very important development in this field some years ago was supported by the Alzheimer's, under the auspices of the Alzheimer's Association and support of the association, is a CSF quality control program specifically for AD biomarkers that has permitted tracking and ultimately improving interlab performance. And we'll show a little bit of that data in a moment. The availability of fully automated immunoassays is now a reality. There are two or three that are out there now at various stages of maturity that are making a real impact and finally getting rid of this issue of center-to-center, lot-to-lot sources of variability that had plagued the very good but still limited RUO immunoassays. We recognize the need for additional biomarkers due to the complexity of this disease, the heterogeneity of it, and so on. And finally, and emphatically, blood biomarkers are increasingly of interest and under study, but you saw that trajectory of ups and downs. I think we're really at the earlier stage in that trajectory with respect to blood-based biomarkers. But the good news is, again, with the very vigorous support of the Alzheimer's Association, there is a formal group attacking in a very systematic planning, in a very systematic way to address the issues in blood-based biomarkers. So, highly automated, the Roche Elecsys, the Fuji Rebio Lumipulse, and the Euroimmune ADX Neuroscience. These are three companies dedicated to knocking the crap out of, excuse me, these, let's get it done. Come on, let's move on. And I think we're at that stage. I truly believe that. Some excellent semi-automated methods, the Simoa high sensitivity system, the MAGQ immunomagnetic reduction based system, and mesoscale diagnostics have been dedicated to developing AD biomarkers, new as well as the classic ones. And of course, mass spectrometry is a leader in the antibody independent space, but there are other very interesting technologies out there, including genetics, miRNA, neurally derived exosomes, RT-QuIC, shake test, and aptamers, all of which are contributing each in unique ways. So here's the data regarding, simply regarding, precision performance. If we look all the way to the right at the bottom, we see between 4 and 6 or 7% precision across labs using the same platform, using the same aliquots split across all the labs, versus what we had been experiencing, which is anywhere from 15 to about 22% CV, which is just not at all acceptable, and so on. So objective data, it continually accumulated three times a year through these blinded testings that are done. So progress in method standardization, then just a little bit further. I think we've got a good handle on analytical performance now. I think the data is compelling. What is also an important element of this process is, again, sponsored by the Alzheimer's Association, is getting the manufacturers together to be as helpful to one another as well as the community in regards to let's build the best possible assay kit so we can move on. And that has been happening at a very excellent level. And I do have to give a shout out to the Alzheimer's Association leadership because they know how to do this. Production of a certified standard reference material for A-beta 42. A-beta 42, one of the stickiest proteins known to man, and one that has bedeviled manufacturers over the years and decades. And I think finally, a lot has been achieved to stabilize that, including the development of certified reference materials became available in December 2017. So several companies are collaboratively working with the CRMs to get their calibrators oriented off of the certified reference materials to, again, to promote harmonization across methods. Our colleagues in Gothenburg and ourselves at UPenn have developed a reference methodology for A-beta 42 based on mass spec, and these are formally recognized by the JCTOM as reference methods. And we're well underway now in doing the same thing for A-beta 40 as well as tau. Now some data. This is data from the ADNI study, the data was generated as part of a within the ADNI study, but analyzing the data, we collaborated with our colleagues in Sweden in the BioFinder study to develop the data to analyze and understand it for what it will tell us. And so among the things we always do with this kind of data is look at frequency plots. When you do that for A-beta 42, if you use mixture modeling, you can recognize two apparent, roughly speaking, normal distributions and abnormal on the low side, low concentrations, and normal on the high. But what really nailed home the value of the mixture modeling technique is look at the graph below with the red and the blue. The red, those are folks who are positive by amyloid PET, fluor beta pair PET. And the blue to the right are those who are positive, negative by amyloid PET. And when you do a lowest type analysis to develop the curves based on the natural shape in a more detailed way than the model does, they're practically superimposable on what we see with mixture modeling. Now look at the log of p tau to a beta. You talk about a bimodal distribution. It's not perfect, but it certainly is. One is able to model it. And then when you do the same thing, when you look at the data by virtue of who's positive and negative by fluor beta pair, they match up very, very well. But what is interesting in this study, and that's the reason why I emphasize the neuritic plaques and what's in them, is that there is better concordance with fluor beta pair PET of the p-tau a-beta ratio than there is of a-beta 42 alone. And we believe it's because there is some tau that's important in the neuritic plaques, and so that's a hypothesis. But we're not the only ones to have this kind of data. Our colleagues at WashU, Schindler et al. Published around the same time a very nice study with very comparable results done independently of us in the ADNI study and in the BioFinder studies. And this is just a reminder that we have mature technology, mass spec technology, reference level for measuring A-beta 42, and that now is being used to measure A-beta 40 using the same system. I have to do a shout out to Magdalena Koretsky in my lab, who's done a yeoman's job in this field. So commutability studies, center-to-center performance comparisons, all of which were done, and then finally describing the CRMs were integrally involved in that process. The certified reference material I mentioned to you, here's the official certification document for it. And this is just an example of one of the immunoassays. It's the Roche Elecsys, but it's being done with the others as well, to show that not only are these methods precise, but they are accuracy based finally once and for all. And with the RUOs, we were nowhere near achieving that. So as was done with amyloid PET, to get harmony across the three different FDA-approved methods for detecting plaque burden, we're doing the same thing in CSF across different platforms. And this is just, this does exist. They are for sale. Here are the data for the certified reference materials. It's CSF-based. I wanted just to touch bases again briefly on the fact that in our field, we're now using amyloid PET as the standard of truth for detecting amyloid plaque burden when we evaluate our immunoassays for CSF biomarkers, and you can see the data here. A very nice summary of this was assembled by my colleagues when we spent a year developing the appropriate use criteria for CSF testing in AD. Now published in Alzheimer's and Dementia. We paid a lot of attention to this data when we developed the appropriate use criteria and the scientific basis for them. A reminder of what all the pre-analytical factors are that we worry about and the state of knowledge of these. When you look at this, it becomes clear that one way to simplify the whole thing is to draw a sample into the tube you're going to analyze in the analyzer. And I can speak about this in the panel, but we have a study that's well designed. We hope we'll start within the next month to two that will test that out in a very real way across the Alzheimer's Disease Centers Network in the US of A. Finally, let's come back to the patient. This is an actual case presentation a neurologist colleague of mine shared with me. This, you can see briefly the history of this 77-year-old white male, married, retired MBA executive for a nonprofit corporation. He started to develop issues over the prior 2 years per his wife's history in terms of forgetfulness, finding important documents in the office, things of that nature. So memory issues beyond normal forgetfulness. Even being more withdrawn and quiet at home in terms of behavior, but still active and fully functional. So this is a person who was deemed to be an MCI patient. So the MoCA testing was done. And I think the test results were 23 out of 30, I believe, if I'm reading this correctly. Virtually all these folks get an MRI scan to rule out the possibility of hemorrhage, big time hemorrhage, infarctions, intracranial masses, and the like. The findings based on the radiologist read of these scans is findings consistent with chronic small vessel ischemic changes, but nothing else remarkable in that picture. So my colleague is a practitioner who uses CSF testing and sends it out to a commercial lab that has an LDT, a lab-developed test, that satisfies the rules and regulations of the FDA governing the use of tests for commercial purposes. To make a long story short, his A-beta 42 was low, his tau and phospho-tau were high. The two hallmarks that, as Cliff was saying, using imaging or using CSF, that tell us this is a pattern consistent with Alzheimer's disease pathology, and so patient care instructions. So the decision was that this MCI disorder that this patient presents with is certainly consistent with the presence of AD based on the biomarker data that you saw. So there's the regimen, and then down below, what can we do today beyond the very limited donezip, Epizil, and so on, that do not impact the disease process but do relieve some of the symptoms, is take all medicines as prescribed, physical activity, cognitive stimulation, social engagement. All of these things are what our neurologists, of course, are telling patients who have this circumstance. Finally, since we do believe we have very mature stage of these biomarkers, we decided within the ADNI study database to do the ATN type analysis, an initial analysis. But in this case, we wanted to combine CSF and imaging biomarkers. And one of the driving rationales for that is, if I'm a patient and I'm seeing my doctor, that doctor's got to use every bit of data they have to the extent they can with confidence. And if they have imaging data, great. If they have CSF biochemical biomarker, great. If they have both, it might be even better. And so here, using FDG PET as the index of neurodegeneration, CSF A-beta 42 and total tau, and phospho-tau, sorry, for the T part of the ATN. And again, FDG PET for the N. So what do we see? The top line is someone who's amyloid positive, but tau and neurodegeneration negative. It's fairly flat over 4 years of time. But then if we add tau, we jump from a 4 year of 11.6% progression rate to 40% progression to dementia rate. And now if we go to A plus, T plus, N plus, we're all the way to 80%. Consistent with what Cliff was saying. On the other hand, if someone is negative for amyloid, they don't have Alzheimer's disease by definition, but they do have other issues all the way out to late, or the A minus T minus N plus, which has a progression rate to 31% at 4 years in this data set. The important thing, though, thinking about that patient again, is if that patient tests negative for amyloid, it's good news in the sense don't have Alzheimer's disease, and about 40% of these MCI folks were in that negative category. That's a lot of people that you've been able to help in this way. On the other hand, if I'm A plus, T plus, N plus, I'm likely to progress pretty rapidly. But the important thing to recognize here and informs us as we go forward with all of this and learn more and more is we do want to get a neurodegeneration test, be it biochemical, imaging already exists and are in good shape. And finally, I'll go very quickly on this because I've basically run out of time. We're all interested in the possibility of a good, solid blood-based biomarker. I think it is fair to say that we've made a very good start in this area. We've got a lot of work to do at the pre-analytical as well as the analytical level, and keeping in mind that the signal that we see is a lot smaller than what we're seeing in CSF. For example, amyloid positive versus amyloid negative, a difference of 14% in the ratio in one particular study. So 10 to 15% difference is what we're looking at as mean values across the two populations. So we've got a lot to do to make use of that data for practical purposes, which are to develop a good screening test. And on that note, apologize for being a little late. Thank you for your attention.
Our next speaker, Samantha Hutton, joins us from the Michael J. Fox Foundation, where she is the Senior Associate Director of Research Partnerships. And Samantha's actually joining us by phone today. So Samantha, can you hear us?
I can, Danielle. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. And we will project your slides here. So if you can just tell us when you're ready to advance, we will do so. And Samantha will be talking about biochemical biomarkers in PD.
Great. Thanks so much, Danielle. And thanks to Linda and Hartman, Phil, Mike, and Rosa for this kind introduction to present today on the overview of biochemical biomarkers in Parkinson's disease as part of this symposium. I'm sorry I couldn't be there today in person, but I've really enjoyed the presentations and the discussion so far, and I'm definitely happy to take questions after this talk and the second one that I'll be giving today. So if we move on to the next slide, I just wanted to start with a very quick overview of how biomarkers fit into the Michael J. Fox Foundation's overall research funding strategy. As I'm sure you know, our mission remains to find a cure for Parkinson's disease through disease-modifying therapies. But as the field continues to push forward towards that goal, we fund research to improve the symptoms of people living with Parkinson's disease today, as well as address what we view as field-wide challenges to drug development. So these include how to develop and define cohorts, how to educate and engage patients in clinical trials, tackling regulatory hurdles, as well as developing clinical skills and biomarkers for the purpose of patient care and clinical trials. So to date, MJFF has invested over $250 million in biomarker research to ultimately assist with diagnosis and monitor disease progression, as well as to stratify patients in trials. So if you go on to the next slide, I think we can really bucket our strategy into these three definable categories. These include generation and maintenance of field-enabling cohorts, as well as other resources, methods validation and standardized protocol development, which we've already talked about, as well as discovery and verification efforts. And all these pieces really complement each other nicely, as we've been hearing about today, and as I'll show you more in a minute. So if you go on to the next slide, I thought I would really frame today's discussion with this schematic, which depicts the life cycle of Parkinson's disease from the pre-symptomatic prodromal period on the left to the onset of symptoms and diagnosis in what we call a de novo population through disease progression and significant impairment or late stage PD. And the biomarker needs for patients who are navigating these disease phases, as well as clinical trials recruiting these subjects at each of these stages of PD, are different. In the case of secondary prevention trials, for example, the goal is really to identify a patient population that would likely phenoconvert within the time frame of a trial, perhaps 12 to 18 months, let's say. So really a crucial biomarker here for this type of secondary prevention trial would be biomarker enrichment and biomarkers of phenoconversion. In the case of patient diagnosis and de novo trials, the biomarker need is really centered around finding the Parkinson's patient, weeding out subjects that would otherwise skew the trial because they actually have something else, like DLB or AD, for example. De novo trials would really benefit from improved accuracy and early diagnosis. But in the later stage trials, I guess really in all cases, especially as it relates to patient care, there still remains a great need for biomarkers of progression. And here we can also think about opportunities to identify fast progressors or slow progressors, or people who will progress more with relevant symptomatic features like cognitive impairment, for example, or other relevant ways that we can stratify patients. So what I thought I would do in this talk is to share with you the types of biofluid, biochemical biomarkers that are being worked on in this context of how these biomarkers might address the various types of patient as well as clinical trial needs that I just outlined. So if you move on to the next slide, clearly in Parkinson's disease there are some populations of Parkinson's patients that we can define. For patients with familial PD, genetics is a reliable, stable binary pre-symptomatic biomarker, obviously with the caveat that there's incomplete penetrance in the case of LRRK2 and GBA mutations, for example. But I think it's also important to note here that sporadic PD does contain a substantial and stable genetic component identified by GWAS. So if you go on to the next slide, you can start to think if you start with genetics and then layer on demographic information such as things like smell loss and family history of PD, age and gender, we can achieve reasonable enrichment for Parkinson's disease. This is actually a model by Nalls et al. That's been confirmed in multiple studies, and you can see here that the area under the curve is excellent. Obviously, this list isn't exhaustive, and there are other things such as imaging like dopaminergic scans or DAT scans that can be used for enrichment with an obvious caveat that these are more costly. But models like this are far from being operationalized for clinical trial use. So on the next slide, I've highlighted some opportunities, I think, to leverage what we're learning from Parkinson's disease biology towards biomarker development with these two examples here. So on the left, there's the leucine-rich repeat kinase 2, or the LRRK2 protein. This is the greatest known genetic contributor to Parkinson's disease. To date, direct measurement of LRRK2 levels and activity, especially in the central compartment, have been very challenging to the field. And we've invested in biology studies of LRRK2 to really demonstrate that there are at least 11 RAB proteins, which are validated LRRK2 substrates. And you can see here data on the left from Dario Alessi's group in Dundee demonstrating an increase in phospho-RAB10. This is by Western blot in R1441G LRRK2 mutation carriers compared to healthy people. And we've been developing antibodies and subsequently immunoassays for a lot of these RABs, which could potentially facilitate subject enrichment, for example, in prodromal trials, or may even serve as biomarkers in idiopathic cohorts. And on the right here is another example of biology meets biomarkers. Roy Alcalay at Columbia University has previously demonstrated that lysosomal enzyme glucose-3 residase has diminished activity in GBA mutation carriers compared with controls. And this is something that we're currently following up on in our longitudinal idiopathic Parkinson's progression markers initiative cohort that I'll tell you about in a minute. But you can see here how phospho-RAB levels or GCase activity assays would be useful to enrich for putative LRRK2 inhibitor or GBA-targeted drug responder trials. And you could also imagine assessing these as early markers in at-risk or even idiopathic patients given the pathway biology component. So if you move on to the next slide, similarly, we've known that inflammation has been thought to play a role in Parkinson's disease, but a systematic evaluation of the various chemokine and cytokine panels in biofluids has not really been performed until recently. So here I'm outlining an ongoing effort, which is a collaboration with Cohen Veterans Biosciences, to analytically assess the reliability, reproducibility, sensitivity, specificity, range of a variety of these plasma and serum biomarker panels. And I know there's a similar FNIH Inflammatory Biomarkers Consortium initiative that, Mike, you're leading, and this is coordinated assessment of samples from the AD field and the MDD field using, I think, the Quanterix and MSD platforms as well as mass spec approaches. So all this towards really understanding some of the validation criteria and sensitivity and specificity measures of these different assays to understand how reproducible they are and ultimately inform which ones maybe should and could be deployed in larger Parkinson's disease cohorts. I really can't underscore the importance of validating assays in this way. This is something that we've been talking about all morning, so I'm not going to belabor the point, but really understanding how to assess assay performance at this level in a round-robin approach like this is crucial, but it does take a lot of work. It involves a lot of players, and this is something that Charlotte and I will be discussing more in the next session as well. So if we move on to the next slide, just switching gears a little bit, we can use things like targeted proteomics to identify new candidate proteins, which could emerge as relevant for differential diagnosis or as more accurate diagnostic markers. So this is an example of some work from Dan Chelsky at Caprion, looking at three neurodegenerative disorder cohorts. This is Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and Huntington's diseases. This group found 49 proteins, which were significant in PD, 25 in AD and 25 in Huntington's, obviously with some overlap. You can see here that the most significant hits are depicted where blue is the downregulated proteins and red are the upregulated proteins. Not surprisingly, the upregulated proteins for PD are in the neuroinflammation space, whereas those that are downregulated in PD, again, not surprisingly, were related to things like protein handling and axonal growth. So this initial work in MJFF's BioFind cohort was subsequently verified in an independent cohort in Britt Mollenhauer's DeNova cohort, where actually 14 of the downregulated proteins and 8 of the upregulated proteins remain significant. So again, really important to verify these results in multiple cohorts. And of course, the next step is to really hone in on some of these markers, either alone or in panels in CSF or in blood. But this is an example, I think, of how proteomics can emerge as a useful tool for identifying biomarkers, in this case, for differential diagnosis or even prognosis. So if we move on to the next slide, there are specific markers that have already emerged, which could assist with differential diagnosis, but they need to be confirmed with more studies and in more cohorts. They're not new markers to this group, but here I'm showing a meta-analysis suggesting that neurofilament light concentration in CSF of multiple systems atrophy and progressive subnuclear palsy patients is higher relative to PD, which could indicate that NFL may serve to separate out atypical Parkinsonism syndromes from Parkinson's disease. On the right here, this is some unpublished data from Britt Mollenhauer, where, again, in the DeNova cohort, NFL was assessed in a cohort of patients which included people with Parkinson's disease, healthy controls, and people with other neurodegenerative disorders. Here you can see the CSF NFL is decreased in PD and healthy controls compared to the other neurodegenerative disorders, and there's a significant correlation of the CSF NFL with the MDS-UPDRS Part 3 and total MDS-UPDRS for the PD group. So CSF NFL is something that we're actively following up now in an MJFF validation study in our PPMI cohort. So on the next slide is just another analyte to potentially consider for us with respect to differential diagnosis. This is YKL40, a marker of microglial activity. This is just a figure pull from the Olson paper demonstrating significant reduction in CSF YKL40 in PD subjects compared to control MSA and tauopathy patients. In addition, the cerebral spinal fluid levels of YKL40 here were significantly lower in patients who had synucleinopathies compared to those who had tauopathies. So this is just another analyte of interest that we're, again, actively assessing for validation in our PPMI cohort now. So I've talked about PPMI a little bit. If we move on to the next slide, once we have relevant PD biomarkers that we think are PD specific and that we've assessed in one or more PD cohorts to demonstrate significant differences between PD and healthy controls, then you know it's great for them to move on to validation well-characterized longitudinal samples. So I thought I would spend just a little bit of time talking about MJFF's flagship longitudinal biomarkers cohort. This is the Parkinson's Progression Markers Initiative, or PPMI, that's been mentioned a few times. So at a high level, the PPMI study tracks around 400 newly diagnosed PD patients, almost 200 healthy controls, 65 Parkinson's disease subjects who don't have any evidence of dopaminergic imaging deficit. These are the SWED subjects, about 65 at-risk subjects. These are people that either are at risk due to loss of sense of smell or REM sleep behavior disorder, and 600 affected and unaffected genetic carriers. And all of these people are followed for a period of 5 to 13 years. So these people undergo motor assessments, cognitive assessments, imaging scans, and are now being activated with wearable sensor data and devices. So we collect biofluids from these patients, including DNA, RNA, blood, urine, things like iPSCs, as they come in for their study visits, and all of these biosamples are available to the research community upon request. And all of the data coming out of PPMI is available in real time for download. And if anybody's interested, I've put the link up here if you would like access. So if we move on to the next slide, I thought I would just highlight some of MJFF's ongoing efforts to identify new biomarkers of PD through the PPMI study. So recently we launched the first large-scale RNA sequencing effort to in Parkinson's to elucidate differentially expressed genes that are changing in PD over time. And you can see here from this chart the really impressive number and certainly diversity of PPMI samples that are being analyzed as part of this effort that we're told is the largest RNA sequencing effort available anywhere. So we're really excited about this, particularly the read depth is really comprehensive. It captures as many RNA species as we can. This includes mRNA, microRNA, long non-coding RNA, and circular RNA. So we're really excited about the high-dimensional data profiling that can be done, especially through integrating this data with the genomics, epigenetics, and the other clinical and imaging information that's available from the PPMI cohort. So this effort is part of a collaboration with the Accelerated Medicines Partnership, or AMP-PD effort. And on the next slide, I just wanted to share some other ongoing AMP-PD efforts. So AMP-PD is a $24 million public-private partnership, which includes MJFF, the NIH and NIDS, the FDA, and pharmaceutical partners. This RNA sequencing data that I was just telling you about sits alongside other PD cohort RNA sequencing data. This includes MJFF's BioFind cohort and the PDPP cohort from NIDS, as well as the hybrid biomarker study. So in addition to the transcriptomics data sets, there's also whole genome sequencing data from all these cohorts. And then the important thing is that all of these assays have been deployed in these cohorts using the exact same methods. And the data will also be harmonized with the clinical data sets across these studies that will all be available through an open access knowledge portal, which is slated to launch later this summer. So if we move on to the next slide, there are two other PPMI efforts that I wanted to highlight quickly. The first is a collaboration with Roche to use their Neural Toolkit assay panel. We'll be doing that on almost 2,000 longitudinal PPMI CSF samples. This is the same Roche Elecsys platform that has been used, that Les mentioned, for the 80 biomarkers panel for A-beta tau and phospho-tau. You'll see that NFL and YKL40 that I mentioned earlier are also a part of this effort. So it'll be exciting to see some preliminary data in PPMI in a subset of samples later this year. And another collaboration between MJFF as well as Roche, Novartis, and SomaLogix is to assess, again, a subset of PPMI samples on a 4,000 panel of aptamers. This is using, again, PPMI samples from the different cohorts and really looking forward to seeing some of that data and potentially whether there are novel targets that get identified later this year. So on the next slide, we continue to explore new biomarkers as well as to revisit different ways of measuring some of the old hats. One example is the alpha-synuclein seeding assay. This is the PMCA, or protein misfolding cyclic amplification assay, that Les also highlighted in his talk. But another type of seeding assay is the real-time quaking-induced conversion, or RT-QuIC. So you may have heard of one or both of those for prions or for A-beta or for alpha-synuclein. But all of these assays work by detecting minute amounts of misfolded oligomers and taking advantage of their ability to nucleate further aggregation through a PCR-type amplification reaction. So there were two investigators that were approved to look at these two different flavors of alpha-synuclein seeding assays, one PMCA, one RT-QuIC, in the exact same set of BioFind CSF samples from the MJFF cohort. Again, this is another example of how investigators can really work together to validate their results coming out of their own assays or their own cohorts In this case, everything was done in a completely blinded fashion. And the results from this BioFind study really demonstrated high sensitivity and specificity, as well as a high degree of overlap, actually, between the false positives and the false negatives that each investigator independently identified. So this is something that's exciting. As Les mentioned, it's an antibody-free approach, so definitely there are benefits associated with that. And we're hoping to validate and assess this longitudinally in our PPMI cohort in the near future. So moving on to the next slide, I've shared with you a little bit about the ongoing data generation efforts with PPMI, but I also wanted to highlight some of the analyses that are underway to identify, in this case, different types of Parkinson's disease progressors. This is by mining the really rich biofluid and clinical data sets that are available from these cohorts. So here's just an example where it was found that lower baseline CSF A-beta 42, again measured by the Roche Alexis immunoassay, is associated with greater longitudinal increase in non-motor symptoms, and this is measured by the MDS-UPDRS Part 1. So this is just an example with data like this coming out of PPMI, how we can really start to identify people that are fast progressors or slow progressors, or those that might go on to demonstrate Parkinson's disease with early cognitive impairment and other different subtypes. So we can really think about stratifying these patients into clinical trials based on their progression rates and their particular subtypes. So on the next slide, I've been talking about biomarkers in people who have manifest Parkinson's disease, but what about people who would go on to develop Parkinson's disease, people who are currently in the prodromal state? Certainly there are several well-accepted risk factors that may make somebody more likely to go on to develop Parkinson's. These include things like REM sleep behavior disorder, RBD, hyposmia, or smell loss, and of course the genetics that I already mentioned. But, you know, none of these are guarantees. Once we've identified these subjects, we then need to consider enriching, potentially using dopamine imaging scans, and then you can end up with subjects who are at even higher risk to potentially develop something like Parkinson's or another synucleinopathy, and this is sort of the framework for thinking about how we could potentially design prevention trials. So if you move on to the next slide, we ideally, again, would want biomarkers that could really predict who is going to develop Parkinson's disease long before the onset of symptoms, ideally something that we could measure in blood or CSF. So this is a figure from submitted PPMI manuscripts spearheaded by Britt Mollenhauer, where you can see that the level of total alpha-synuclein in the PD group, shown in red, this is significantly decreased compared to the healthy controls in green, and that's not new. This has been demonstrated before, but interesting when we start looking at the RBD subjects, the at-risk subjects for REM sleep behavior disorder, which is the black line, they tend to fall in between the control and the PD subjects, whereas the hyposmic at-risk subjects or the smell loss subjects in blue tend to recapitulate Parkinson's disease alpha-synuclein levels. So this is something interesting, I think, to keep following and also to consider as the prodromal cohorts of PPMI age. We'll definitely have more longitudinal time points to follow up on, but this is something that we continue to be interested in as we look for more concrete measures of phenoconversion. So on the next slide, admittedly, there are a small number of prodromal subjects in PPMI. And when we start thinking about recruiting for even one or multiple prevention trials, if that's hopefully what's in our future, we really need a large number of subjects. So in the Parkinson's field, we're keeping a watchful eye on the Alzheimer's trials and thinking ahead to try and anticipate the potential field-wide need to identify these people and recruit the prodromal subjects. And I think there are two major opportunities that potentially could be leveraged that are ongoing MJSF efforts or investments to support prevention trials. The first one is our Fox Insight platform. This is an online clinical study for people with Parkinson's disease and the Parkinson's disease community that can be active contributors to improved disease understanding and therapy development and clinical care all through the use of patient-reported outcomes through online surveys. So if you're not familiar with Fox Insight, it's a unique longitudinal cohort. Now it has about I would say 35,000 people with and without Parkinson's who participate in this clinical research entirely online through surveys and questionnaires. And all this data is available to the research community through an online database that we have affectionately named FoxGen. This was actually launched yesterday, I believe. So you can imagine how this resource could potentially be leveraged and would need to be scaled to assess PD risk factors like things like constipation or smell loss or sleep disturbances and family history all through online surveys. And then this and other opportunities for remote smell testing through scratch and sniffs and genetic testing through spit kits and digital assessments using wearables could ultimately enable us to prioritize the in-clinic efforts for those individuals who sort of moved up the pyramid who were even more at risk. And then eventually we could bring those subjects in for things like imaging scans to really enrich for a population. And then ultimately we could leverage the infrastructure that we built for PPMI to start following these people with the highest likelihood of developing Parkinson's disease via more intensive and longitudinal clinical assessments, which could also include biofluid collection for biomarker studies. So all this to say, this is something that we're thinking about as we try to anticipate where the field is now and where the field is going so that we can really be at the ready for what we think is coming on the horizon in the future. So my last slide, or my second to last slide, if you move on to the next one, is just an example of what I hope is a key takeaway here, but also throughout the day as we're having these discussions. I think it's we can all recognize that it's probably unrealistic that we're going to have a single biomarker to assist in all of these different functions and fit all these purposes, or even just have one biomarker that serves for both diagnosis and progression, for example. So in the example on the slide, these investigators had utilized a Luminex assay for A-beta 1 to 42 tau, phospho-tau, and total alpha-synuclein to demonstrate that the combination of using total alpha-synuclein, A-beta 1 to 42, and either the total tau or phospho-tau improves the differential diagnosis of Alzheimer's from DLB, PD, to an area in the curve of 0.9 if you're comparing that to the alpha-synuclein alone, which was 0.75. So all this to say, I think we really need to start thinking about these combinatorial approaches to assist in diagnosis and progression monitoring, and this is definitely something that we're keeping an eye on as we move our assays through the pipeline. And I think with the wealth of data that's coming out of things like PPMI and the AMP-PD effort, which is all open access and available to the research community, we hope that this will allow us to determine whether multiple analytes and also other modalities can be combined in meaningful ways to demarcate phenoconversion from prodromal PD or to quantify Parkinson's disease progression. So just to sort of summarize on the next slide, kind of like where we think the field stands and sort of the outlook with respect to Parkinson's disease, I think we can all agree that biomarkers for Parkinson's, including ways to enrich populations in clinical trials, opportunities to assist in differential diagnosis, having objective measures of clinical progression, and demarcating phenoconversion are equally urgent. there's obviously overlap here, and one biomarker can span multiple utilities, but on the flip side, it's unlikely that just one biomarker or one biochemical biomarker will emerge to singularly tackle any of these problems. And perhaps it's more realistic that a combined biochemical and even multimodal approach, which would include things like digital endpoints or imaging markers, would be most successful. And as we continue to develop new ways to measure these analytes that we think are important, for example, like alpha-synuclein, we also try to consider new targets that are emerging from the much better biological understanding of underlying pathophysiology that we're learning from some of our biological studies, which still is by no means enough towards understanding the biochemical and biological mechanisms of Parkinson's. But ultimately, we hope that this will enable precision approaches to identifying and enriching subjects based on having a better understanding of the underlying disease mechanism. And as these new candidates continue to emerge from this pipeline, it's definitely important to maintain the rigor through the validation and replication efforts, which we'll talk more about in the next section. But we hope that some of these large-scale efforts around genomics and transcriptomics and lipidomics and proteomics that are currently being deployed now across multiple cohorts will elucidate some new targets. And I think these rich data sets from longitudinal, well-characterized cohorts that continue to be made available to the research community in real time will really allow us to start deploying advanced analytics and computational biology approaches to really dig in and analyze them. So I think I've told you a lot, and I'm going to stop there and happy to answer any questions before we move on to the next section.
And Samantha, there are no questions in the room, so if you wouldn't mind proceeding with our next topic, which is a shared session between Samantha and Charlotte, and this is on CSF and plasma markers, reference materials, pre-analytical standardization, and method optimization.
Okay, great. Thanks, Danielle. So this next topic, I thought I would specifically talk about some of the challenges that we've observed with respect to fluid-based biomarkers for Parkinson's disease and some of the solutions that we've tried to employ to tackle some of these field-wide. So on the next slide, I thought I would just highlight some of these challenges. So the first one is that without a robust biological understanding of Parkinson's disease, knowing what to measure and in what biofluid can often be difficult. Even still, when we do see something interesting, it's can be difficult to interpret what it means with respect to the disease process. And this is sort of a theme that emerged earlier with respect to biomarker qualification that I think we could talk more about. But another challenge, particularly for biomarker assays, again, has already come up, this lack of rigorous validation and replication of promising results by different groups and different cohorts. So oftentimes, data is coming out of single labs who have access to research-grade assays. And not surprisingly, this leads to conflicting reports in the literature and ultimately confusion in the field. So another challenge is that there's limited access to well-characterized clinical samples for all phases of biomarker testing, including not only validation, sort of the end game, but also some of the early biomarker discovery and assay development work. I think there are particular challenges inherent in big data sets, which include lack of harmonization and standardization in the way that the data is first collected and then processed, as well as actual logistical challenges like housing the data and storing it. And often because there's so much of it, there's a significant time lag between collection and analysis. And some of these other ones I think are less relevant today, but I think we need to, as a field, continue to strategize ways to liaise with people who are experts outside of our particular area. And this is something that we try to do as much as possible, engaging, for example, people who are working in the computational biology space or leaning on our Alzheimer's colleagues to help inform some of the assay development work that we're doing. And this last point, I think, again, maybe not super relevant to today's discussion, but I think an overarching theme really should be that when people work in silo and when data isn't shared publicly, then that often leads to efforts being duplicated and negative results not getting published, which slows things down for everybody. So really a lot of what I'm going to be sharing today is also about how we can incentivize people to work together more collaboratively. So on the next slide, I mentioned one of the key challenges that we face is we don't necessarily know what to measure and where or how to measure it. So I'm not going to go into this in excruciating detail, but on the left, I'm just highlighting some of the examples of things that we can and have measured as potential Parkinson's disease biomarkers. These are PD-specific markers like alpha-synuclein, as well as some general biomarkers of neurodegeneration like NFL-beta. As well as non-invasive measurements or pathway markers around cellular dysfunction or autophagy. But even if we feel confident that we know what we want to measure, then there's the question of how do we measure it? Do we look in biofluids like CSF? Should we be looking in tears or urine? We're doing studies in all of these. A big thing now is whether we should be fractionating the fluid into exosomes, for example, and if so, what protocol do we even use and how is that standardized? We've talked today about looking at the protein level, but also looking at the DNA or the RNA level. So I think these are all things that we're considering as we recognize that there's no shortage of ideas, but the challenge is that we don't have great evidence validating any of these methods. So on the next slide, just to say that we've tried to tackle this by funding broadly, both with respect to the types of things that we're measuring, like volatile organic breath compounds and wearable technologies and immunoassays, but also with respect to funding across the different stages of the pipeline through all the way from biomarker discovery to optimization and validation. So on the next slide, a challenge that is definitely not unique to our field is that oftentimes there's a lack of replication and validation of promising biomarker assays. So as I said, we've seen reports from single labs, sometimes even conflicting, for example, whether a post-translationally modified form of alpha-synuclein goes up or goes down in a particular biofluid in PD subjects. And again, this speaks to the need for replication of results by different investigators in different cohorts that are assessed blinded, and rigorous validation of the assays. So I already mentioned on the next slide about inflammatory biomarker studies looking at key assay parameters in a round-robin fashion, but this is also another example of an alpha-synuclein seeding assay round-robin that we performed in a specific set of samples. So this was a validation and replication effort that we undertook really because we realized that the assays to measure alpha-synuclein that have been developed to date, again, are primarily for research use only. They haven't been validated for integration into controlled clinical trials. So we really wanted to support an all-star team that was experienced in assay development and validation that would share reagents and samples and methodologies and data in real time. So here for this project, the goal was to compare four alpha-synuclein immunoassays head-to-head. These were the BioLegend ELISA assay that's traditionally been used in our PPMI study, the Mesoscale or MSD assay, the Roche Elecsys platform that we've talked about today, and this assay by ADX Neurosciences also that's been mentioned today. And you can see here that the PIs leading each of these arms were those PIs that had originally developed the assay. So these were the originating labs or really the experts. And underneath that, you can see that we've listed satellite labs where these are labs that have the capacity and the capability to test these various assays that are available to the research community. And all these groups looked at the same set of 50 CSF whole blood and saliva samples in a blinded round-robin style fashion. And finally, these samples were also assessed on a mass spec-based assay, which was used as a gold standard to compare the immunoassay results and the reference standards. And if you go to the next slide, the key question that this project was really aimed at addressing are delineated here. These include things like how the alpha-synuclein values from each of the assays compare to each other, how a given assay performs in an originating or an expert lab versus a satellite lab, how different kit labs performed, and how the immunoassays, again, correlated to the mass spec. So this project is complete, and the results have been published. But a similar effort is now underway examining the lower limit of detection and range, the precision, sensitivity, specificity of several different modified alpha-synuclein assays, things like phosphorylated alpha-synuclein. And this type of validation includes and should include really characterizing and testing the various protein standards side by side to hopefully enable us to better understand exactly what form of the modified alpha-synuclein each assay is measuring and which ones are most reliable and robust to ultimately understand if they track with disease. So on the next slide, the assay validation efforts that I was just telling you about are described, but they're all part of a larger consortium of investigators who, alpha-synuclein investigators who are brought together to share data, resources, assays, protein standards, and protocols. And this is what we've called the Investigating Synuclein Consortium. This Investigating Synuclein Consortium published a white paper in 2017 with key recommendations on how to measure alpha-synuclein, including things like pre-analytical variables and analysis considerations. This included standard operating procedures that were suggested for CSF, as well as blood-based collection. These were things like when to perform the lumbar puncture, what type of needle to use, what type of tube to collect the CSF sample in, as well as sample processing recommendations. So for sample processing, this was something like how long the time to processing would be from the time the sample was collected, a comparison of tube types and the processing temperature. Some examples here are shown on the slide. Limiting freezing and thawing cycles was another recommendation. There were other recommendations around developing hemoglobin cutoffs for spinal fluid samples, which would signify blood contamination and exactly where that cutoff might be. And finally, this group has also generated and characterized alpha-synuclein reference pools, which are being used across assays and across studies measuring alpha-synuclein to really enable cross-study comparisons. So I think we can all appreciate that these aren't really the sexy aspects of science, but this white paper from the top alpha-synuclein experts in the field who were all able to come together and share unpublished data will hopefully inform the community on some of the key lessons learned to date. So on the next slide, I just also wanted to highlight that in some cases, the overarching field-wide question isn't even at the stage of which assay is more reliable, but rather it's more like where can we detect it or how can we detect it. And this is the case for biofluid assays aimed at measuring the leucine-rich repkinase 2 protein or the LRRK2 protein that I mentioned earlier. So in this case, we brought together key industry stakeholders and expert clinicians to collect things like PBMCs and neutrophils and other complex matrices so that we can utilize a variety of different collection protocols to really hone in and determine what biofluid and assay panels might pair well together for further validation and testing. So on the next slide, that brings me to the challenge around access to collecting clinical samples. So clearly there's a need for disease-relevant biosamples, not only in quantity, but also as well as quality. So we really need these samples to be well-characterized with confirmed clinical diagnoses and to be non-contaminated. So I think you can appreciate and imagine that there are different stages of assay development, and all of these different stages really necessitate different types of cohorts. For example, you wouldn't want to utilize a precious longitudinal CSF sample set for biomarker discovery when those samples could be better served validating a progression biomarker. So this is sort of the impetus for why we have a variety of different collections at MBFF. We've noticed throughout the years that different studies and different sites all tend to have their own collection protocols, which obviously makes comparing results across cohorts or even between fields difficult, even when the same assays are used. So, for example, in the case of measuring LRRK2 that I just mentioned, we found that it's helpful to compare different collection protocols up front with the assay of interest before implementing a standardized study protocol across sites. And I've already shared some examples of how pre-analytical variables can affect alpha-synuclein assay performance. So really understanding how these types of things occur and how you control for them is really important. But whenever a unified sample collection protocol is implemented, something that we really have to keep in mind is that it has to be realistic. For example, when we were setting up PPMI, we realized that some clinical sites don't have access to certain types of equipment like centrifuges that may be necessary for certain types of protocols. And even still, we found that things like very frequent site training and real-time compliance monitoring for multi-site longitudinal trials is really critical. So on the next slide, this is just a demonstration of the biobanks that MJFF has established that you can see depicted here. All of these MJFF sponsored repositories utilize the same standard biofluid collection SOP for all of these different biofluids that are collected, and the collection protocols have been adopted by clinical trialists and sponsors that we advise. So anybody who is granted access to an MJFF sponsor cohort like PPMI or Biofine, for example, is required to share that data back with MJFF, and that data is made publicly available on our LONI website so that anybody can download the data and associated clinical information. So there are obviously some governance considerations here, such as developing a committee to outline the criteria for sample approvals, and that committee is responsible for evaluating an assay's validation package and determining whether a sample approval should be granted. So then on the next slide, you can imagine how these cohort studies really do generate a lot of data, and something that sometimes gets overlooked is sometimes having so much data, it can be difficult to really know what to do with it. So when there's so much data generated from things like wearable sensors and omics studies, we've seen that there's a lack of tools that are really able to model these disparate data types, which really necessitates curation and harmonization, which is definitely time consuming and also expensive. So there's definitely complexity around cohort specific data use agreements and consent guidelines to consider. Another key consideration when you make data available to the community is what version of that data is going to be available, because this certainly has implications for who can use it. So in some cases, it could be better to make the raw data available, although perhaps that might only be decipherable by an expert with a very particular type of software tool, whereas if you make a processed data set available that could be used more broadly, it does require some degree of processing or alteration before it reaches the community's hands. So there are also logistical and financial considerations of where and how we house big data on the cloud or on external hard drives. I just thought it was worth mentioning here as we're entering into the stage in some of these studies where the wearable and omics study data is just really staggering. So on the next slide, I already talked about our flagship longitudinal PD cohort, PPMI, in the last talk, which is an example of our data sharing resource that's been successfully leveraged, we think, to move the field forward. So we know that this PPMI data is being used and downloaded based on the ticker on our website, which is now up to 3.6 million data downloads as of this week. We also know that power calculations generated from PPMI are being utilized by companies with the goal of designing faster and cheaper trials. I already told you about how the Accelerated Medicines Partnership, or AMP-PD effort, is generating large-scale omics data sets that will be publicly available with the curated clinical data through a Verily knowledge portal that will facilitate collaboration and enable analysis through cloud sharing notebooks. But PPMI clinical and other high-dimensional data, along with data from other MJFF and other PD cohorts, will also be incorporated into Brain Commons. This is a digital ecosystem which will facilitate standardized curation across these different cohorts and also enable cloud computing. And finally, perhaps most excitingly, we're seeing movement in the regulatory space. So PPMI data served as a springboard to enable the Critical Path for Parkinson's Consortium, or CPP, to petition the European Medicines Agency to issue a positive qualification opinion for DAT as a tool to enrich Parkinson's disease clinical trials. So this is really an exciting step forward that could not have been possible without the hard work of CPP to collect and standardize this patient-level data from a variety of different sources, which did include PPMI and others, and to provide the analysis framework that guided this opinion. And I think Diane Stevenson from CPP is going to be talking to you tomorrow. But needless to say, this partnership with CPP is having a real impact on clinical trial design. So this is my last slide, but by way of summary, if you move on to the next one, we think there are many challenges associated with biomarker development and validation for Parkinson's disease, but these are certainly not unique to what I've been hearing today and what I know Charlotte will be presenting next in the Alzheimer's space. But working together as a field to come to consensus around sample acquisition and handling procedures, having these samples easily available for the community to access, setting a standard of practice around data sharing, working together to validate assays and replicate findings. These are all ways that we can move the dial towards more robust, more reliable, and more standardized biomarker assays for patients and for clinical trialists. So I'll stop there, and again, happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Samantha. In the interest of time, we're going to actually ask the audience to hold questions until the panel session so we can move to our next speaker. Samantha, we look forward to your participation in the panel session, though, for any additional questions that may come your way. Our last speaker before the break is Charlotte Tunensen from the Amsterdam University Medical Center. She's a professor of neurochemistry, and she will be adding on to the discussion we just heard from Samantha about pre-analytics and important factors. Thank you, Charlotte.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction and invitation to come here, especially to Mike. Well, I think we realize by now, after this whole morning and afternoon, that standardization is very important. I don't think I need to explain that to you. But I will give some examples from our own experiments and from the literature why it is important with CSF analysis, and also some factors that you would not anticipate on before. So there are several sources of pre-analytical variation that we need to tackle. So they can be at the patient level, for example, whether they smoke or exercise or were fasting before they went to the clinics and for the CSF or blood collection. Another level of pre-analytical factors that we talk about a lot today is about the pre-analytical processing. So how you handle your tube, how quickly do you centrifuge your sample, and it can be very relevant. Another level is at the level of assay performance. So the use of reference material, for example, that has been mentioned already today. So all these aspects are very important, and in the realm of Alzheimer biomarkers, we realized that all these markers could have contributed to the variation that we experienced in the past for the Alzheimer biomarkers between centers. So what we decided is to standardize as much as possible on almost every aspect of the CSF biomarker analysis for the Alzheimer biomarkers. And this has been part of the Biomark APD project, and it was the goal of the Biomark APD project to standardize as much as possible. And some of the results have been incorporated now into the quality control programs, for example. It has been contributing to that. So one of the things that we did was to evaluate the frequency and also the risk factors for post-puncture headache and other complaints. And based on that, we made standardized criteria also to take into account those risk factors and hopefully to reduce those risk factors and frequency of the complaints. So one of these is, we made a movie to illustrate those consensus, the procedure. So there is a link over there, but I won't show it. There is not much time today, but it's very easy to see it because it's published in Alzheimer's and dementia. What we did recently was also make an animation to inform the patients, because if patients are better informed, we expect them to have less anxiety and thereby a lower chance of getting postpuncture headache or other complaints, because anxiety was known came out as a risk factor for complaints. So this animation is also now accepted by Alzheimer's and dementia, so it will be published also soon. In the meanwhile, we will evaluate whether this video really leads to a reduction of complaints. We heard a lot about biobanking protocols, and I don't think we should reinvent the wheel for every other disease and other biomarkers. So consensus protocols have been established in the course of multiple sclerosis network in 2009. They've been updated and adopted by other consortia, for example, for ALS and also for Alzheimer's disease. So those biobanking or collection and biobanking protocols, they are there and they are being used by many centers around the world. So I think we should use them. And here are some examples. So especially for CSF, and CSF A-beta, because A-beta is a very sticky protein, and we realized that there is some absorption of amyloid beta to the plastics. And here you can see the effect. It was most pronounced in the lower volumes. And you can see that there is a reduction of 25% of amyloid beta just by transferring it four times in another tube. Four times is a lot, but three times can happen easily. If you collect it in a tube, then you centrifuge it, then you have some contacts with the pipette tip, and then it can be aliquoted into another tube. So I told you about three tubes already, so three times absorption. There were some rumors that it could be, or there was some evidence that it could be depend on the tube brand. Here we repeated that for the biobank sample, so the smaller aliquots, and we didn't see any difference between the different brands. But the effect was there for every brand. We next questioned whether it's not only the tube, but also contact to other plastics. So here you can see some results where we evaluated whether contact to the pipette tip during transferring from one tube to the other also had an effect. And indeed it was. So this is the experiment, again in two different volumes, 150 microliter and 1,005 microliter. Blue, the control. In red, when an aliquot was transferred, sucked by the or taken up by the pipette tip, and then again in the same tube, and in the other one we transferred, so there was contact with the pipette tip, and then next the CSF was led into the next tube, new tube. So we can see that half of the loss of A-beta is already driven by the transfer or the contact with the pipette tip only. So that's a relevant issue to take into account. Good news, if you do not use A-beta 42 but also A-beta 40 as a ratio, then this effect is lost. So it's counteracted. So essentially, the ratio of A-beta 42 to 40, in my opinion, it corrects for pre-analytical variation. It's not just this data, but other data where we showed that we could normalize the effects of different pre-analytical handlings, especially absorption. So here I had a nice picture, but it should be later. But that will come, so this is a memory test. So I will show you some data about whether body fluids do evaporate during biobanking or storage. But first, I want to lead a little bit more on the absorption to the tubes. So to counteract that, the Alzheimer's Association has formed, together with experts in the field, a unified SOP and a novel tube through which the methods for CSF collection in routine, so not for biobanking, is standardized as much as possible, and there is a limited transfer of the CSF from one tube to the other. Essentially, the CSF is collected in a tube that's immediately or can be immediately put in automated machines for amyloid testing. So there is no more transfer, and I think that's very important. So now the result of the memory test. Oh, there's an animation in there. So now it's back. So this looks like a barcode. So these are the results of the evaporation experiments that we did. And I think it's most important to see and to interpret that there's so much stability. So over 2 years, we did not find any evaporation of CSF, but also water, saliva, serum, plasma from the different tubes and at the different volumes. The very low volume we saw some decrease at 4 degrees, and at room temperature there is some more evaporation. But normally we don't store our samples at room temperature for 2 years, but we included that to hope to see some extreme effects as a positive control. So there is no variation. Other studies that we did, other experiments, was to test the stability of proteins at room temperature 4 degrees and minus 20 in CSF and after freeze-thaw cycles. And again, 7 times, it's very extreme, but we wanted to see some effects. And again, the CSF proteins listed here, they all appear very stable upon delayed storage, and long-term storage or intermediate storage, minus 20, but also upon freezing thawing. So that's the good news for CSF. Well, I can almost skip this because it has been talked about today for a couple of times already. But one of the issues at the analytical level was the use of manual assays with variation. But now there has been a great improvement with the emergence of automated platforms. Also, by the development of reference material and also reference methods, and also by the establishment of international quality control program. This is a requirement if you're a clinical chemistry laboratory. According to the ISO guidelines, you need to have an external quality control monitoring program. So this is an important development in the field. So let's talk about blood biomarkers now. That's an emerging novel realm in Alzheimer's disease. And I think 3 years ago, we would not be believing that that any neurospecific protein could be reliably detected in blood and inform us. But now, through the technological developments, we can. So for blood, of course, we also have to define the pre-analytics. And here are some examples of studies that we did to address the pre-analytics in plasma. For the amyloid blood test that we developed with ADX Neurosciences on the Quanterix platform. I think it's hard to see, but what's very important to capture is that at the left side you see Aβ42 and you see some decline under some conditions. So, yeah, almost. I'm also getting older, so. So we analyzed different sample types, and the two low bars at the right side in every graph, that's serum. So we can see that for Aβ42/40 ratio, that's the left graph. The other EDTA plasma types did not have any effects, but serum levels were lower, but still detectable. And any effects for the other markers, other variables, for example, for delayed storage, you see the ratio again at the left side, and this is almost normalized. While you see some decline in Aβ42 and also the 40 levels. So this delayed storage up to a couple of days, it may affect your sensitivity because we see a decline and we are often very low at the detection levels, especially for Aβ42. So I think it's an important factor to be able to counteract in the future. But you can also see that the decline is mostly at room temperature and not at 4 degrees. So storage at room 4 degrees is something that we can put into practice. Freezing thawing, here we see an effect, so that's different from the CSF. You can see that there is a decline also for the ratio of Aβ42/40, so the left graph again. And it's mostly due to the decline that we see for Aβ42. Here are some results performed by Roche on their amyloid blood test developed on the Elecsys platform. They tested several variables like circadian rhythm and type of anticoagulant and type of collection tube and also the filling height of the collection tube. And I think we can conclude that circadian rhythm is not affecting the amyloid levels. But the type of anticoagulant does. And maybe you could say that it may not be significant, but because the numbers are not high and they did not perform statistics in some way. But I do see that in heparin there is an increase, and it's an increase of 10%. But if you take into account what Les said, that the decrease in amyloid is often only 14%, we cannot afford a variability in different sources of 10%. So it's all very relevant. But for tau, we see really a strong effect. And the type of collection tube, And yeah, the third column in this graph is every time the ratio. It doesn't seem to affect the levels too much. In the feeling hate, I don't think there is really a strong effect, but there is some effect. So, and now we were talking about amyloid beta, but in neuroscience, we are also interested in other biomarkers like neurofilament light, especially for multiple sclerosis. Neurofilament light is now being prepared for approval also with FDA by the Progressive MS Alliance. So there it's also very important to know the effects of pre-analytical variability. Here you can see in a study at the left side that's published already, and it was confirmed by our own data that NFL is very stable upon free-swallowing in the serum. And we also analyzed the stability of storage. And here we see also very high stability of, so these are three examples. So we see a good stability at both room temperature and also 4 degrees for serum NFL. But here we don't know the effect of delayed centrifugation, for example. That has not yet been studied. So that's something to be done. The Global Biomarker Standardization Consortium of the Alzheimer's Association has established a group to tackle the pre-analytics of the Alzheimer biomarkers, especially in blood. So the aim is to develop a unified SOP for the pre-analytics in blood. What we've done, done an inventory of the SOPs used for, so far for blood analysis and blood sample collection. We established the critical differences, and now we're in the stage of to establish what are the most important factors that we should study before we make a unified SOP. Once these data are there and experiments are done, we hope to do it as soon as possible. Then we want to establish unified SOPs, both for research, in cohort studies, but also for routine. So here you see the summary and narrative summary of the inventory. The factors in green are the ones that we think are very important. I think the most variation was observed in the collection protocol, so the time to centrifugation. It could be immediate, but it could also be within 3 hours or up to 24 hours in one single case. So, and that's something that's conceivable to be important because white blood cells can also phagocytose amyloid beta. We have some data for that. I think that can happen if you don't centrifuge quickly. So in conclusion, the pre-analytics are very relevant, both for CSF but also for blood biomarker results. For CSF, absorption is probably most critical, and for blood, probably the conditions until processing. And there are consensus protocols to perform the lumbar puncture for biobanking, also for immunoassay validation, and also the use of reference methods and automation. And all these standardizations lead to less variation in results. And for blood analysis of brain-specific proteins, we need to define the pre-analytics and consensus protocol, and these will be defined as soon as possible. Last, I'd like to... Oh, there's an animation in my presentation. I don't have under control. I want to acknowledge the people from my lab, and also ADX Neurosciences, and especially the Simoa team within my group. Thank you.
The last speaker in this session before the panel discussion is Greg Veit from the University of California, San Diego. And as you all noticed, the title is fluid, but we are going to have to consider functional measures. So I've asked Greg to just talk about how something like a functional measure like EEG might be used. And I think the context of use that I'm familiar that he was engaged in is in the pharmaceutical industry, you might use something like EEG as a measure of drug activity, a monitoring context of use. But obviously people might want to move beyond that. So Greg, without further ado, maybe you can tell us where we think we are with this functional measure.
Thank you, Bill, and thanks to the organizers for pulling this session together. My research has been focused on trying to do something with EEG biomarkers. We used to write at the end of every paper, you know, studies conducted in my lab, and maybe someday this work will help inform new treatments and help patients someday. In working with family studies of schizophrenia patients with Raquel Gur, I became frustrated that it wasn't happening. And so I'm going to talk about how we've tried to move out of our academic lab and into other settings to try to accelerate the pace of CNS therapeutic development. I'm employed by the University of California, San Diego, and by the VA San Diego healthcare system. I do have some disclosures. First, I've been involved in clinical trial studies for many years. I've worked with some of you in this room as a PI of Alzheimer's trials, schizophrenia studies. More recently, I've been working with NeuroSig, an EEG services company that has been focused on bringing EEG into clinical trial studies. I'm a consultant on the EEG analysis pipeline, the standardization, the SOPs, how you can actually bring these things into real-world settings. And it's interesting, these are really the same kinds of problems in drug development that are faced in other settings too, like how do you use the tools of neuroscience to predict and monitor response to perturbations. So some of the work that I'm also doing is with NASA for the mission to Mars in 2030 to try to measure response to CNS perturbations by deep space radiation. From the Office of Naval Research at the Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, where we're looking at how do you non-invasively measure brain reactions to hypoxia or other perturbations in kind of complex operational environments. So just as an aside, this is one of my postdocs who now works at NAMRU, Naval Medical Research Unit, Dayton. And he's trying to study how can you predict and monitor response to different perturbations, in this case, hypoxia. You may have read that sometimes Navy planes have been crashing due to problems with the gas mixture. And so this is him, sorry, I don't have a pointer, with the electrode cap in a hypoxia chamber. And it's really the same kind of question that we have in this context is, how do you scale up? How do you do something well in an academic lab, but then bring it into complex operational settings like in the cockpit? How do you use those same kinds of tools for monitoring brain function to assess operational fitness prior to somebody engaging in an activity that has a potential for catastrophic outcomes, like trying to land on a carrier deck, trying to dock with the International Space Station, trying to land on the surface of Mars? And so one advantage of EEG is that it's you can non-invasively assess these things. But obviously, the picture on the left isn't ready for the stuff on the right. And what I've been told is that the engineering is actually a simple problem. That is, the easiest part is to figure out how to get it built into a flight mask or into a helmet. The hard part is knowing what to do with it and knowing what to look at and how to measure things. So our current approach, at least in psychiatry, is we usually assess somebody with a clinical interview. We give medications. Sometimes psychosocial interventions are recommended, and patients are often hospitalized. But ultimately, it is a one-size-fits-all approach to treatment. And what we're proposing is maybe we can infuse those tools of neuroscience into understanding our patients better and ultimately stratifying them. And these could be different kinds of biomarkers, including some presented this morning. The ones that I'm going to focus on are neurophysiologic or EEG biomarkers, such that if we can ultimately identify individuals who are sensitive to treatments, perhaps we can carry them forward and assign them to treatments for which they're likely to benefit from. Or if our data at the outset of treatment suggests that they won't benefit, we will not subject them to the intervention. So Bill warned me at the beginning that he was going to put me in a different session, and I thought what he was going to do in the warning was bring up some of the problems with the EEG and challenge me and others who are in this field to address some of these problems. And these problems include the fact that this is 1970s technology with poor spatial resolution. Some might even say that it's modern day phrenology. In drug development, a lot of the things that we measure may not be easily translatable. You can't measure it in a mouse or in a rat. They're unreliable. I've heard Bill say that before for many years. And even if you can do it in your special lab, you're not going to be able to bring it out into multi-site global trials. If you could get the reliability up, it might not be practical because patients aren't going to want to have like a bunch of electrodes put on their head. They're not going to sit still for this kind of testing. And even if you could get them to do that, well, it's the things that you measure, like your brain waves, your brain's responses to beeps and clicks, this isn't really the things we care about. Like, we really care about cognition. And then lastly, this is something that I added again today, is the problem of like the gizmo du jour, the gizmo of the day. Like, there's a new gizmo, and we've all been burned by them, where, you know, it's new, it's small, it's portable, it's quick, it has some proprietary algorithm. So I'm not gonna show you anything much about gizmos, and nothing that I'm gonna show you with data has proprietary algorithms. Everything that I show you is published or will be published. It has standard algorithms that can be replicated. Okay, so this, the real disclosures, I'm going to show you the work of the people in my research labs. So they've really done the work. Their pictures will show up in the slides corresponding to their first authorship. So how do we get there? This is not a new problem of how do you select measures and what are desirable measurement characteristics. Many years ago, there was a similar work group, kind of like this, that was focused on how do you advance cognition as an indication for schizophrenia. And the output of that expert consensus panel was that measures need have five criteria for carrying forward. They should have good test-retest reliability, utility as a repeated measure, a relationship to things we care about, like patients' daily functioning. They should be sensitive to different kinds of pharmacologic or other perturbations, and they should be practical and well-tolerated. We tried to extend the same platform for EEG, and this is what my work has been focused on over the past 15 or 20 years, really since then, which is, can you apply some of those same things to EEG biomarkers? And so up at the top of this group, we have those same criteria carried forward, you know, reliable relationships to things we care about, sensitivity to different kinds of pharmacologic agents. We've added some things necessary for drug development, like you should have an animal model that's relatively easy to set up. It doesn't take 6 months to train the animals on how to do the task. And then just focusing at the bottom, the kinds of tests that we use should be low cost. They should be administered by non-specialists in global sites without the need for special environments like magnetically shielded room or soundproof chambers. They should be suitable for use in multi-center trials, but ultimately they need to be useful. Like, we shouldn't just do them for the sake of doing them. They should show some utility. Some of the slides, I'll talk about how we checked off at least some of these boxes going forward. Okay, so one measure that we've used, this is just an example measure, is called mismatch negativity. The first report of mismatch negativity was from Risto Neotinen, shown in this picture here. Mismatch negativity has its own conference. And so I put this slide together at the 20th anniversary of the Mismatch Negativity Conference. There are wide-ranging applications for mismatch negativity. I won't go into all of them. But to say I became inspired to use this measure when I was given Risto's book that he wrote in 1992 that described all of the elegant studies that he had done in undergraduate students at the University of Helsinki. And I'm very privileged to say that we've put together a new book on mismatch negativity and clinical applications. This focuses exclusively on everything from neurodevelopmental disorders to aging to psychiatric applications. And so, again, I'm not in it for the money, but I wanted to really give a shout out to Risto, who has really advanced the field in many ways. And I'm sorry to say that he's suffering from now from some of the same problems that we're here to address. Okay, so what is it? How do you measure it? I won't go into the details too much about like the geekiness of it, but basically we deliver tones to individuals at a rate of a half a second apart. We measure brainwave responses to those tones. They don't have to do anything. They don't have to press a button. They just have to passively sit there in a chair and listen to sounds. We subtract off like that the person heard something, and this measure reflects like your brain's automatic detection of change. You can measure these peaks in a sleeping baby, in a mouse, a rat, a monkey, an individual with neurodegenerative illness like Alzheimer's disease, and in patients with schizophrenia. There are two waves there. One is called mismatch negativity. It's a negative going wave. It's followed automatically by a variant of P300 called the P3A. Both are automatically elicited. And again, you don't have to do anything to get it. Everybody has one, even the most impaired patient has one. Okay, so what can we do with it? First, we can demonstrate that the drug is getting into the brain, that the drug is impacting cognitively and functionally relevant brain processes, that they can show biologically plausible changes in brain networks. We can do fancy things to clean up the data, to look at where things are happening. We can apply modern computational neuroscience approaches to deconstructing the key nodes in a network. And what we've shown is that source level ERPs are substantially more sensitive to group deficits, to clinical, cognitive, and functional correlates, and even more sensitive than the things that we measure at the scalp. So the top here, I'm sorry that this is a busy slide, but the point is that even simple processes like your brain's automatic ability to detect a change in routine stimuli is regulated by a distributed network. And the very top row here, again, I don't think this will work, shows like the correlations at the scalp electrodes. The subsequent ones show source level ERPs. The far right column shows R squared or percent variance accounted for. And a lot of these measures at source level responses account for substantial portions of variance in things we care about, like negative symptoms, daily functioning, and cognitive functioning. Many of them also survive Bonferroni correction because of the magnitude of effect is so large. Again, about 20 years ago, we had some of the first demonstrations by Daniel Umbricht that a drug, ketamine, could impact an EEG wave, an automatic EEG wave, notably that same response. At baseline, the magnitude of it predicted the level of psychotic-like experiences that healthy, normal individuals had when given ketamine. Others, this is work from Steve Siegel, have shown that you can measure MMN in a mouse. It looks pretty similar. The only difference is that the latency is much shorter in mice. That ketamine also disrupts MMN in mice. in those same time windows. We've shown that you can measure MMN in rats with similar looking morphology. Again, the time course is a little different in mice and rats versus humans. And it's also been shown that you can non-invasively measure response to ketamine in non-human primates, even wearing scalp electrode caps, kind of like the ones that we use in our current settings. I'm going to apologize. Sometimes people plot negative up. Other times they plot it down. I've always learned that negative is down, so I'm going to show it that way for most of my studies. But it's a similar kind of effect where ketamine disrupts the MMN response and the P3A response. It even has a similar topography. The first time I met Bill was actually at a glutamate-related biomarkers session that was held in Washington, D.C. I think Linda was there also. I'm not good at my own time estimation, but it was many years ago, and mismatch negativity was carried forward in the kind of statement as a measure of glutamate-related biomarkers. It's used, again, in many other contexts, not just ketamine, not just glutamate system. It's used in for cholinergic systems. It's used for perturbations with hypoxia, nicotinic drugs, lots of different things. This was just where we were at the time, probably, again, 10 to 15 years ago. Okay, so what about reliability? So we did some studies in schizophrenia patients and healthy control subjects using 40-channel EEG system, not exactly high density. We used like the best available kind of analytic approaches of the time. On the y-axis, we have the test-retest intraclass correlation coefficients. Over to the left side, we have paper pencil neuropsych tests, the kind that we were using at the time. And on the far right are mismatch negativity and P3A measures. And what we found is that these measures have substantial test-retest reliability, even over 1 year, even in schizophrenia patients. And in some cases, those test-retest reliability coefficients exceed what we see in kind of paper pencil neuropsych tests. I would bet you that the cog battery that Raquel Gur and Ruben Gur have developed has better test retest reliability than some of the paper pencil cognitive tasks shown on the left. But that's where we were published in 2012. Okay, so even if I can do it in my specialized laboratory, how do we bring it? Can we feasibly and reliably bring EEG to global CNS trials? This is a trial that was conducted in Europe with 25 sites. There are probably not 25 dots on the screen because some cities had multiple locations, like London had 4, Barcelona had 2. The study was conducted in Poland, Czech Republic, Slovakia, Spain, and we've shown that yes, you can do it. Yes, you can put on electrode caps, even in elderly individuals. The woman on the left, she is not an Alzheimer patient. She's somebody from our lab that we know and has agreed to be in the photograph. You can bring the equipment. The equipment really isn't much. It's a laptop and it's some things on the back of the chair there, but these were brought into little villages, little towns in Slovakia. Sometimes it took 4 hours to get to these places, but that's where the Alzheimer patients were. And it really isn't any harder to prep a high density EEG or train sites on how to do a high density EEG than it is a gizmo. This is a Brain Products EEG system that has some customizations from NeuroSig to make it more idiot-proof for use in sites where they have no prior experience. Out of the 25 sites, I think 21 of them had no prior EEG experience, but because of SOPs, standardization, training methods, training approaches, QA, you know, immediate feedback and turnaround on the data sites, the data recordings. In one of the presentations from this afternoon, they talked about the long lag time between, you know, getting the data up into the cloud and turning it around. These are reviewed within hours, and there's feedback delivered to all the sites with correctable issues. It's actually pretty easy to prep. So in the bottom right corner, we show, like, this is me. I'm not an experienced tester prepping the sites, and they change colors. I don't know if you can see, but it changes from red to green when there's gel in it. This rocking is excessive. It's more than is needed, but I'm new, and this is kind of how I was taught to do it, you know, many years ago. But you can really prep, you know, one of these electrodes in just a few seconds. It takes about, I'm told, about 7 minutes to prep 64 channels, usually with two people on it, and it's generally not that big a deal. It takes about the same amount of time to prep one or two channels if you have to, like, move the hair and put goop on the hair and stuff. So, anyways, it's feasible. It's doable. Oh, it's playing by itself now. Maybe you can see again. Watch the thing change color. As soon as I put the gel in, it changed color. And I'm doing just time wasting here. And if you had the volume, you'd hear somebody say, you don't really have to do that. You can move on to the next one. Just wait till it turns green. Okay, so what is the impact on reliability? Like, so great, I can do it in my specialized laboratory. What about in that site, that study where there are 21 different sites? Can you extend the method beyond? And so I just want to talk about the impact of reliability on sample size and openly think about where you cut costs and how you cut costs. So if you have a measure with good reliability, so on the y-axis we have power, on the x-axis we have sample size, you can measure, you can get an MMN with a gizmo. You can get it with a consumer-grade device that you order out of SkyMall magazine. You can do it. But that doesn't mean you want to do that for something that has go-no-go decision-making kind of criteria attached to it. It doesn't mean it's worth it. If you have excellent test-retest reliability, as shown in this slide, it could save you 20 subjects. So, in terms of statistical power. So I was asking one of the other speakers, what is the typical rate of Alzheimer patient enrollment per site? And the answer is 0.2 to 0.3 subjects per month. What is the typical cost associated with each Alzheimer patient enrolled in a trial? And it ranges from $10,000 to $50,000, depending on how invasive it is and what is involved in the trial. So if you can shave off 20 subjects, you could save a lot of money in development. And again, I want to emphasize that the high-density EEG substantially improves the signal-to-noise ratios, even if you're only interested in the stuff at the scalp. They substantially improve your ability to detect small changes in brain functioning attributable to a drug. They do not take longer to prep. The high-density EEG are not less well-tolerated than the gizmos, and they are not less comfortable for the patients. You can measure these things in about 20 minutes. Notably, in the study that I showed you with the 25 sites, the test-retest reliability coefficients range from 0.94 to 0.96 using mismatch negativity, P3A, other measures like auditory steady-state response phase locking, evoked gamma power, P3B, sensory registration, and so forth. Some other things were not as highly reliable. They are things like resting state EEG. We get them. We get asked to put in things like different ratios between eyes open, eyes closed, beta versus theta, and low frequency, stuff like that. You know, you can get it all. But in general, you can get nearly perfect reliability even in Alzheimer's subjects, even in schizophrenia patients, and of course in healthy control subjects. That's all pre-exposure data when they're recorded twice. Okay. We have other demonstrations where we used a gizmo. I put a warning there, this is a gizmo. I feel comfortable saying that because I helped build the gizmo. These were modified startle boxes that we had laying around, and we made Franken boxes so that you could record EEG with just a couple channels. It's a large sample size. And what I wanted to emphasize here is that on the right panel with the colorful figures, that is every subject's average data. We publish the raw data from each subject. It's amplitude color-coded, where on the y-axis in the top colorful panel, each line in there is an individual subject. So a more blue means a deeper mismatch negativity. A brighter red means a larger P3A. There's a section of healthy control subjects called NCS in like the bottom half, and on the top half are the schizophrenia patients. You can see there's tremendous heterogeneity in the data set, and that variability is our friend. Oh, I've been learning it. When I asked for pictures of people from the lab, one of the graduate students, kind of in a snarky way, sent me this tweet that he received at SFN. Oh, you saw it too? Oh, you took the picture. Oh, great. So I'm not on Twitter. Maybe I need to get on Twitter, but he sent me this. He said, here, use this. So there's his picture. I thought it was cool. He's using, he just had a paper published in PNAS showing nonlinear dynamics and how you can use nonlinear features contained in the raw EEG signals to identify distinct subgroups of schizophrenia patients. Okay. So getting back to the things we care about, we and many others have shown that these EEG measures are related to cognition, to daily functioning, to clinical symptoms, even to really distal things like whether somebody can live independently or work. We've showed that in many small-scale trials, and there are probably, you know, many dozens of papers published on this area in schizophrenia and related neuropsychiatric illnesses. Actually, the book goes through many different disorders too. With this large COGS data set, though, we can look at the multivariate relationships contained within the different nodes. So I won't go into the structural equation modeling stuff, but just to say, these are the main nodes that are in there, and we've replicated that EEG measures are related to cognition, they're related to daily functioning, that cognition is related to negative symptoms, clinical symptoms, as well as to functioning, and clinical symptoms are also related to functioning. And you can identify like mediational models. But basically, it is an information processing cascade where things at the very earliest stages of information processing carry forward and impact higher order cognitive operations. The really cool thing about this data set, though, is that once you have those coefficients, is you can start to model and say, what would a one unit change, a one microvolt change in early auditory information processing do to cognition? Well, according to the model, it should support a pretty large effect size change in cognition. Now, we've done stuff, published papers here, showing that you can move EEG biomarkers with even a single dose of a pill memantine. We know memantine is not like the most robust, potent drug for schizophrenia. It's a proof of concept study that one pill can move a reliable biomarker, single dose malleability. But getting back to our model, we also know that one pill is not going to make somebody smarter. And so what we don't know is what is the time course, and what are the other requirements for meaningful change in things that we care about? Could cognitive training be one such platform for potentiating the benefits of a drug? Can it be used alone? And for more like proof of concept stuff, we used an auditory-based cognitive training intervention. I won't go into the details of it. It's been widely used in schizophrenia studies. It's been used, really pioneered by Sofia Vinogradov's group. We've done some studies showing that this kind of cognitive training platform can improve verbal learning and reduce auditory hallucinations, even in treatment refractory inpatients who are court mandated to long-term stay. And that's Michael Thomas down at the bottom. So it's a suite of exercises. I'm not going to go into them. I'm just going to skip through these. But basically, like many interventions, it is time and resource intensive. Failure has consequences for the patients as well. Not all patients benefit. In our case, 35 to 40% of patients really don't show any meaningful benefit to this intervention. And so what our questions were is, are the EEG biomarkers acutely sensitive to the neural systems engaged by the first dose of cognitive training, kind of like what we did with memantine? Does the cognitive training even work when delivered over 3 months? And do any of the measures at baseline predict response after 3 months in this very impaired patient population? So in our first study, this is Veronica Perez. When I asked her for a picture, she gave me one that says, "I voted," so she gets the big picture. She found that the EEG biomarker at baseline was related to the exercises themselves, that the amount of benefit that you had in the 1 hour, the progression was correlated with the size of the response. She also showed that the EEG biomarkers were malleable. They moved in response to the 1 hour of training, demonstrating again single dose malleability, even to this kind of non-pharmacologic type of probe. More recently, we've looked to the source that there are changes in the source contributions even after 1 hour. So identifying source level ERPs, she found that a suppression of ACC was present after the 1 hour of training, but not in the OFC-related source. Okay, so now, does this malleability after 1 hour do anything? Does it predict response? Does initial baseline reactivity predict response? So again, Michael Thomas, this is in this long-term locked inpatient care facility. We had a study of treatment as usual versus those who underwent targeted cognitive training. There are blue arrows to indicate that these patients were on high doses of antipsychotic medications. They had been ill for 15 or 16 years on average, and they had pretty significant impairments on a cognitive test battery, the MCCB, the same battery that I showed you the slide about at the beginning about what are the key characteristics of measures needed to develop a cognitive test battery. Okay, so just quickly, I'll say that the cognitive training platform worked even in this very severe patient cohort, that there was a significant improvement in verbal learning and memory after 30 hours or 3 months. There was a significant reduction in auditory hallucinations, not exactly something that we expected, but it kind of makes sense because the exercises are auditory based. And importantly, we found that the malleability of the response after the 1 hour of the treatment predicted which subjects improved in verbal learning after 30 hours. So here the orange dots are the cognitive training group, the blue group is the treatment as usual group. And it predicted, there was also P3A amplitude that predicted improvements after 30 hours. It also predicted reductions in auditory hallucinations after 30 hours. And most recently, he's now working on how do you combine, we talked in the earlier about like multiplexed or composite variables. He used regression weighted values to generate a single EEG composite index and found that a Z-score of greater than or equal to 0.55, kind of shown in the middle in the tiny table there, yielded pretty good sensitivity and specificity. So that's a new direction that we're pursuing, is how do you pull these things together. So our revised model now looks like this. Our current situation is imprecise medicine, one size fits all. You give a pill to a bunch of people. There are some people in there who are, you know, likely to be sensitive to the pill. But on the whole, you have a lot of non-responders. What we're proposing, and that would be a failure of treatment, what we're proposing instead is that you do some screening for a biomarker or composite biomarker at baseline or after first exposure to a treatment to identify individuals who are sensitive. You carry the treatment forward only in the people who are sensitive. They receive the longer-term therapeutic dose. And we hope that this strategy is likely to yield a higher rate of response. Again, it's a subgroup analysis. It's not one size fits all. It's a general model, but that's where we're trying to take it in our next steps. And so I'll stop here, and I want to again say thanks to the group of people who actually do all of the hard work, trainees in the lab. And if any of you know people who want to be postdocs or trainees, please let me know. We need more. So thank you.
So before we get started with discussion, we'd like to ask the new members of the panel that were not part of the presentations, if you could introduce yourself and give a 1 to 2 minute summary of some relevant thoughts that you have related to the discussions that the presentations we've just had.
Hello, this is Mehmet Kosoglu. I am a member of the biomarker qualification program in CDER. I work with Chris Laptak. And do you want our comments right now, like general or?
Yes, please.
I was gonna talk about the analytical validation mostly, and I'm really happy that they a bunch of the presenters mentioned that it would be nice if it was a straight up process that you go from discovery to analytical validation to clinical validation, but that might not be the case in every time, and it might become an iterative process, and some of the clinical data or the discovery data might inform the decisions you make during analytical validation. That was a good point.
Hi, everybody. My name is Su Jian Wang. I'm currently the biostatistics liaison of our CDER biomarker qualification program to our OND, which I coordinate with Chris Laptak. But I'm also helping our medical division, the medical imaging division, on the various statistical issues. So you know I'm a biostatistician. From today's presentation, at this point, two things strikes me. One is the ATN mentioned by the expert, and I found it has a very good analogy to oncology, specifically in the breast cancer area. They exactly have three categories of biomarkers, and on top of that, they actually add a signature, biomarker signature, called a mammoprint to identify patients who are more likely to progress so that they can do a prognostic enrichment. So on the ATM per se, they actually come up with 10 biomarker subtypes. And they were able to identify treatment that's going to be better for them. So in that kind of setting, if we're going to talk about analytical validation or pre-analytical validation, it's pretty straightforward because you're going to do it biomarker by biomarker of the three different categories. Plus, now talking about the mammoprint, which is actually a 70 gene signatures from microarray experiments. So I heard a lot of interesting conversation this morning about what about the biomarker panel? What should we call it? Should we call it a composite or something else? Our office, biostatistics, we are thinking about that heavily, and we are also thinking about having a workshop later on this particular topic. So I thought maybe in that format, which is from an oncology setting, that the analytical validation and pre-analytical validation actually has been done with this 70 gene signature. So that may be an area that we can learn from. So that's my take up to this point.
Steve Piccoli, I'm in clinical biomarkers and companion diagnostics at GlaxoSmithKline. I'm here as an assay expert on developing and validating biomarker assays along with the critical path white paper lead author that you heard about before, as well as a former FDA panel member and CLIA lab chief. So I've been in diagnostic medicine for a very long time. And I find that there are a lot of similarities, and Sue Jane took the good example that there is from the oncology field and used that. But there are a lot of those learnings that have been derived in cardiovascular and oncology that fit to what I've seen here today. And they, yes, there are some differences in small things. The brain caps are, never seen one go in oncology before, but maybe it will happen. But the questions that we ask and the way we interpret them, this is following the pattern of what I've done in oncology, cardiovascular, other fields as well. And it's so it seems that, you know, this pathway is reasonably well mapped out and should be able to be adapted to this group very easily. And so I've been impressed with the breadth of the data shown and the progress made toward harmonizing everything, because this was a terrible push in other fields of endeavor a few years ago to get the standardization down pat.
Thank you very much. And I took the liberty of putting up a reworking of the discussion points for this session to invite questions from people to just sort of highlight certain themes that maybe we might want to dig into a little more. So the first bullet is, you know, this: what is the level of evidence needed for utility? People keep talking about utility, and we talk about formal context of use. But in reality, and that's the first bullet, we decided as a field, in the Alzheimer's field, that the CSF and PET imaging biomarkers were good enough for entering people into trials, even without the qualification process. And I think the opening talks from Dr. Stein and Leptak emphasize that there is a path. So I just want to remind everybody, we don't have to go through the qualification path to find something useful and all. But it really comes down to, well, what is the level of evidence needed? For Parkinson's disease, I think when the efforts were started, I think we thought that, for instance, the cerebral spinal fluid would yield useful biomarkers more quickly than it has done. We heard there are many promising leads, but we still aren't there yet, which is fascinating considering how much time and effort have been put into that. And as we think forward to the functional brain disorders, which is where one of the themes of this is, can we do something where we don't have a known pathophysiology and come up with truly useful biomarkers? And this is where, of course, Greg Light's talk suggests that maybe something is, you know, far away from brain function as electrodes on the skull. Could they really be informative? And that would be fantastic if it proves out they can. But then, but what's the level of effort to really nail this down? Greg touched on some of it. I mean, so how much do we need to worry about pre-analytic factors, analytic processing of data, and ultimately, is an appropriate analogy? Is it okay to think of functional brain measures, performance characteristics, and somehow using something like we do for biochemical assays? I think the question was raised earlier, the further we get away from biological plausibility, the greater the demands will be, at least from the FDA perspective, on the performance characteristic of the measure, if I heard that comment correctly. And unfortunately, as we move away from Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease, we will be moving much further away from known pathophysiologies. So anyway, I'll stop there. And I just wanted to set up the context of this and then open up the whole session to questions and all. But because ultimately where we want to go is to, at the end of tomorrow, we want to think about what should we be doing in the future. So, okay. So I'll stop there. Questions?
I'll just add that I think part of the reason we haven't progressed further is that we don't talk to each other enough. We're often doing these studies in our academic labs, completely oblivious to the context that Steve described in other fields. Often academicians like me, we are not even familiar with the requirements of the FDA. We don't know what we should be looking for. And so I really want to thank you all for coming here so that we can at least start to talk together, because I think, you know, some of these things are not flashy. And NIH usually doesn't like psychometric studies. They're not innovative, they're not, you know, impactful. And so I think we need to like really build the momentum to actually build the platform ourselves. So thanks to the organizers for making it happen.
A couple of experiences I'd like to share that as I look back over the past 15 or so years. The first one back in 2004, when the ADNI study got funded, the announcement was made, everybody was excited. We went to Toronto for that first meeting, and Mike Weiner or someone gave a little bit of a review of what we actually committed ourselves to. And one of the things we committed ourselves to was open access to the data before it's published. And when we heard that reiterated, it dawned on us that this is what we really did do. And you know, publish or perish was where we were at. So there's no question in my mind that the impact of that open access to the data so that others can use the same data you're starting to look at with their own hypotheses, they may overlap with yours, dovetail with yours, whatever the case may be. It does a couple of things. One, the quality of the data that we're putting up there had better be, at its best. And we're always learning and getting feedback to help that happen. But there are a number of benefits, and it relates to what you're saying about discussion, crosstalk, and the like. The second event that strikes me. I was at a meeting under the auspices of the Alzheimer's Association, and Henrik was in the room, I was in the room, and other colleagues, and we were using these research use only tests, and we're trying to explain some phenomena that were happening. And we, you know, did our theories and so on. But that kind of crosstalk where at the end of that session we said, you know, we really do have to, if we're going to move this field forward, one, it helps to have an outside push. And the Alzheimer's Association, from our experience, has been that. But it's the crosstalk and the feedback from one's peers that can be a real spur. So that's a couple of things.
Raquel Gur from Penn. One of the points that was raised in the morning session was the evolutionary graphs of the evolutionary component of multiplex biomarkers, that each one of them, if we look at sort of lifespan, has a different trajectory as it develops. And there are multiple of them, there's not one of them. What's your thoughts about, in the case of Alzheimer's, Greg has shown, I'll preface it, has shown that in remote places where research is not conducted, simple measures that relate to electrophysiology can be well tolerated and high quality data can be collected. If we move Alzheimer's as a model, and it is a model for in neuroscience, to get the quality of data that is related to biomarkers with amyloid and PET studies it's the Rolls Royce. If to disseminate interventions more broadly once you get a hit based on the Rolls-Royce, you also know that there are simpler measures that can be obtained, and this is the relationship between them, than in fields where there's, you know, we are just beginning, such a more complex neuropsychiatric disorder, such as psychosis. Why not set it up a priori that we get multiple measures and we understand CSF according to well advanced effort that has been done in Alzheimer's and now in Parkinson, but we also obtain simpler measures so we can reach out and think about, you know, distribution, because most studies nowadays introducing novel or trying in application of existing pharmacological agents are not done even in the United States. They're done abroad. So what will we need to be able to do that?
The beauty of Alzheimer's disease is that we have very specific biomarkers, and we can measure amyloid, beta, and tau, and there we are right at the core pathology. And I usually make the comparison with cancer, where they analyze all kinds of different proteins and RNA in exosomes, and via an algorithm, they come to a verdict. Hey, you have cancer or not. But there is no intuitive relation with the disease. It's just a number and algorithm. And the beauty of Alzheimer's disease and the amyloid biomarkers in blood is that we know the relation with the pathology. So I think, but still, of course, we need extra biomarkers. I'm talking about biomarkers and fluid biomarkers. But I don't think that there is a simple solution for such a complex disease and so much heterogeneity. But what we want to do, of course, at the end, is have very simple biomarkers, maybe blood spots or maybe tears or saliva, but it's just not there. So I think we must be very happy with the CSF biomarkers that come to a specificity and sensitivity that are so high now. And I think we just need to continue on that. But I think, in contrast to what you said, that we talk a lot with each other. So, and also, as Leschot indicated, with the ADNI and also with the fluid biomarkers, there are large consortia, there are multiple platforms where we can discuss. And there has been a great concerted actions also to improve all kinds of analyses. So there is communication, and we can communicate via the internet and via the literature. So we can exploit that to further develop our biomarkers and also the multimodal biomarkers.
Yeah, but to follow up on Dr. Gerst's question, though, in the Alzheimer's and Parkinson's field, since you have your pathophysiology as sort of your gold standard to refer to, are you also collecting what she was referring to as more simple markers that might turn out to be measures that are being formative? In other words, I asked Cliff Jack this morning, but he had to leave. How deeply is the characterization of subjects going on across the sorts of measures that might be accessible anywhere in the world? Is that going on in those cohorts as well?
Well, there are studies ongoing, like digital measurements of how well people are able in doing games and for their spatial orientation. If you call that simple, I think, well, it's ongoing. But these are large epidemiological studies, and we need to show that they are valid also for the individual, because that's what we need at the end. We don't need large epidemiological studies, but the value for the individual. And that's and therefore I also want to explain on the level of effort to assure performance of the assay, as you indicate. I think we need to make sure that we are as accurate as possible, and not to lose any information for an individual patient because we didn't do our homework well. And it's not too difficult to tackle the pre-analytical variation, and we learned from the CSF analyses and the problems that we had what we should do. So for any novel biomarkers, we can speed up the process.
Hi, Leah Davis from Vanderbilt University. So my question, I think, is for you, Greg, although I be happy to hear the input from the rest of the panel. So you showed some really interesting results on a sample of individuals with schizophrenia and controls on the MMN. Yes, okay. And there was a lot of, and you commented on this, inter-individual variability and a lot of heterogeneity. And I was thinking about the fact that both EEG traits and schizophrenia, of course, are both pretty highly heritable phenotypes. And whether you think there is some opportunity for genetics to be used as a tool to remove some of that variance so that you can really better observe the treatment effects that you're trying to see, and whether you guys, as a follow-up to that, are collecting blood.
Yeah, so that study was part of the Consortium on the Genetics of Schizophrenia study.
Okay.
So that was the explicit goal, was to use MMN as an endophenotype to try to determine whether the genetic architecture of endophenotypes, including MMN, was simpler than the genetic architecture of a fuzzy disorder like schizophrenia. So that is exactly what we've been doing and what we've been working on. I know Raquel is on several more conference calls than I am, trying to pull together various approaches to genetic analyses.
Well, that's great to hear. Thanks.
Thank you. I will try to, I thought I'd say some things about some of the questions that Bill raised as to express an opinion. And I have to say after that, this has been a really interesting set of discussions. And I don't know, like other people sitting in the room, I feel like there's been so much going into my head that I've gone from green to red now, but with some fear about what may come out of my mouth. I think that Bill raised a question kind of subtly about what do we do when we move into functional measures, functional brain measures. And it really, I think, is a question related to the issue of what happens when we transition from neurologic disorders where we know a mechanism, we know tissue pathology, we know things we want to measure with some target. And when we move from that world into psychiatry, which I suppose 150 years ago was the world where people didn't have too much hope about finding these things, so these are the psychiatric disorders now, where we have problems about moving forward. We're not quite sure that our diagnoses are very good. They're global syndromal characterizations of highly heterogeneous populations, useful for making some immediate treatment decisions, but not perhaps so useful for guiding drug development. So what do we do about that problem we haven't solved? And so how do we move forward with biomarkers in a condition where we don't have a good target, and we don't have postmortem pathology to tell us what we should look for, and our plasma and our CSF measures have never gotten us very far? So what do we do? So we can go in the corner and cry and get a little nihilistic about this. But the other problem is that we have a high density of our population suffering with psychiatric disorders who are looking at where we are in treatment development in the last 50 years. And I been doing this for near 50 years now, and where we've gotten from profenazine to imipramine to where we are now is not something that was at the level of advancement that we would have hoped for. So the need to get biomarkers to identify patients for stratification purposes is really crucial. Because we're kind of stuck with that. It's on the one hand, we've got all these problems that it's hard to move forward. On the other hand, if we don't make some progress, the drug development for our patients is really going to be stuck. So we're kind of caught between high need and high risk. So those are the things we're struggling with. So on the one hand, to deal with the questions, I don't think there's any question that the biomarkers we want to use in MR or EEG for psychiatric disorders have to be held to the same standard of any kind of plasma assay or CSF. If we cannot show reasonable reliability, we've got your curve problem. And so I think that we have to be able to establish these sort of things and cross-site similarity and similarities all the things that you guys were talking about with fluids are really logically, I think, necessarily have to apply here, otherwise they're not going to be very useful. So I think that question is kind of easy. But how to move forward strategically with the
what the challenges of working in psychiatry is harder to sort out. And I think it's for me, I'm glad as someone working with psychiatric disorders to have a good amount of this meeting addressing this issue, because there's a recognition across important players that we need this. And so I think that the EEG data that you showed is very promising. I think it's crucial to show the reliability that you did. There's good genetic data coming out of COGS. There's good genetic data coming out of the BSNP study. So there's a utility for pulling out populations that are genetically distinct. And where we really are I think in a problem state is we've got to find ways to work with industry to be able to try some of these very promising biomarkers in a state of hope and recognition that it's going to be primarily empirical associations that we can establish that aren't going to be guided by an a priori biomedical hypothesis. And we're going to have to look for them. And if we do, hopefully we can pull our populations apart with large sample studies in ways that will be informative and that can pull us in and give us guidance for things that we can bring into trials to see if the heterogeneity we can pull apart electrophysiologically or in terms of MR can be applied. I mean, there really are a lot of exciting subpopulations that have been identified with electrophysiology and MR within our major psychiatric syndromes. And I think if we try to exploit that and we can find enthusiasm for trying that in some of the early phase studies, it would be really important for our patients.
So I'm going to throw that as a question to Les and Charlotte, representing the neurologic things, where you would have noticed that, and I'm not sure what's been done in the Parkinsonism, and I don't know if Samantha's on the line, but I know for Alzheimer's, there has been a rather large investment in a functional brain marker, fMRI. That data was not shown. When I asked Cliff why, because this is important, he said it's too noisy. So Dr. Sweeney's point is it's not clear. The reason we put this up here is it really possible to have similar performance characteristics in terms of noise with functional measures that we see beautifully documented for fluid measures, or even for structural brain imaging measures? And what should the criterion standard be? What should we expect? I don't know if Samantha's on, if somebody wants to comment.
A meeting in which that topic will be a focal point, because that's one way to start to get at, well, what is the data? What are our problems?
Okay. I'm sorry, I didn't look over there.
Trust individual labs, and every lab, you know, corrects for multiple comparisons. We all do this perfectly correctly, correct, right? So we all do that individually, but collectively, when you think about 100 labs looking at the ADME data, do we have a problem of overfishing this data set? And is there some justification for actually holding back data as a validation set with the problem of the bureaucracy of having to figure out who gets access to that and how that's presented? Is that how we would do ADNI today, or would you stick with the original way you did it?
I think Dr. Laura Beckett should comment on this. Since Mike Weider isn't here to nail that one.
In the initial design of ADNI and on following it, I'd say, first of all, it doesn't matter what you do. If you put data out there, people are going to analyze it wrong. There are people who just do dumb stuff. And to some extent, it's on us to do it right and make our papers the ones that are done well. And we're not the statistics police or the science police who can reject every paper on the planet and keep it from being published in some fly-by-night journal. And this can happen with almost anything. But if we try to establish clear standards And indeed, I'm going to talk about some of the standards I consider for biomarkers that are important tomorrow. If we try to establish clear standards and really make it clear in every paper we write, in every paper we review, in every grant we review, that these are the expectations. And I know the FDA is very robust in their consideration of these, at least in my interactions with them. I think that helps. And I think we just have to trust at some point that we do a good job, and people who then, you know, some of our colleagues have written major critiques of false discoveries and overpromising, and that's, I think, about the best we can do. But trying to hold back data, even a subset, you know, there are enough, I think it's possible, if you're doing it right, to hold back a subset yourself. In fact, in ADNI, we, in ADNI 1, designated a subset that could be used if people wanted to do universal comparisons. We designated split half. We designated subgroupings for tenfold cross-validation. So we have tried to make ADNI something that if people read the documentation and do it right, it can be done right. But, you know, I wish we could keep bad science from turning up, but we have to really try, I think, this group and the people we talk with train our young people to do it right. Anyway, so yeah, I would still do ADNI the same way. And I would probably really even emphasize more the documentation that we have about holding out for cross-validation. That's where I would stand on it. And I don't know if that answers your question. But.
And I think that we are unfortunately out of time. So we're gonna say thank you to our panelists as well as our presenters today, and we can continue the conversations in the reception later today as well. So thank you all.